Good morning. I'm Bob Giles. I'm one of the deacons this morning. Beth Lindsay, Linda Betch, and Beth Nichols are also serving this morning. It's been a busy morning signing up. After 3 years, we're doing communion the old way again. One of the things is that if you prefer not to have the passed plates and would like one of the little packages, if you'd raise your hand now, one of the deacons will bring one around. If we don't see any hands, we're fine. But deacons will be passing. And not everybody has been communion here at the North Campus before, so we passed the plate halfway down the center aisle and back. And there'll be someone going down the side aisles as well and up into the balcony. So new things, new churches, here we go. A couple of announcements I have, and then if you have any announcements, come on forward at this time and we'll get you in. We're trying to keep announcements very short, so you've got 30 seconds. I'll start my timer, and next, just as a pre-notice, next Sunday, being Easter, we will not be doing the come forward for announcements bit. So get your announcements out of the way now. A great welcome to everybody here this morning and to those who are with us on Facebook or YouTube. We're 1 week away from Pastor Chuck's time with us. He'll be here next week for Sunday, but I'm very pleased to say that we have amongst us this morning Tad Allman-Morton. Tad, why don't you stand up? And Tad's going to be with us through July. So Tad comes to us from the Hampshire Association up in Massachusetts, and Chris Marischuk, who was here in December, actually tweaked Tad's ear, and it all worked out. So we're all set for the next 3 months until our new pastor comes on August 1st. So. We do have, we'll be singing out of the New Century Hymnal, which is the black hymnal underneath the pew in front of you for in most cases. Let's get some announcements started.
You set me up well, Bob. Tad, welcome. Tad was my hometown minister for 13 years. My mom's Charlotte, so nice to have you. So new churches, new things. Please read this bulletin that is in your announcement. It's what was e-blasted last week. It's all about what's happening 2 weeks from today and the 2 days prior to meet our candidate. It will conclude with a vote on that Sunday. Everyone's voice is important. Please make an attempt to attend. If rides to the events to meet the candidates or to vote are a challenge, please contact the church office and we will find a ride for you. There is also a Zoom option. So please, please take a look.
Good morning, I'm Beth Lindsay. I'm here for Open Cupboard Pantry downstairs. I have two announcements, so hopefully I have a minute rather than 30 seconds. How many like spring flowers? I'm not a very good flower arranger, but for the month of April, Open Cupboard is the beneficiary of Stop and Shop's Blooming for Good campaign. So if you purchase one of these bouquets, it says Blooming for Good on the wrapper. We receive a dollar for each bouquet that is purchased. The other thing that we have coming up in May is the Connecticut Food Shares Walk Against Hunger. Open Cupboard will have a team, so if you would go to Food Shares Walk Against Hunger website and plug in Open Cupboard, you'll see our page. We're looking for walkers and for donors. So anything you would like to do to help us out would be greatly appreciated. All the funds that we raise will come directly back to Open Cupboard. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Don Shaw and I'm from the Outreach Committee, and I'm here to talk about recruiting about a dozen people to work with me on Earth Day, April 22nd. This would be the third year in a row that we have assisted the Granby Land Trust in cleaning up properties. This year, the Land Trust would love our congregation to help clean up along Mountain Road and Donahue Road near the Mary Edwards property. And 2 years ago, we did that, and that spurred the land trust to start this annual event. So those who worked on it 2 years ago know that we filled my truck bed with trash. There's an unbelievable amount of trash that's left on the road. So there'll be an announcement in the bulletin, but contact me, and I'd like 12 or so people to help me out. And it can be fun being with me sometimes.
Good morning. Excuse me, I'm Bill Ross. How many of you missed the concert last Saturday? All right, don't miss the next one. It's going to be really good. It's Dave Gunning. He's here from Nova Scotia. And tickets are selling fast. I sold almost 10 on Friday. Thanks to Mara, reserved 8 tickets. So we're up to almost 40 tickets, still 3 weeks to go. And it holds 153, according to the fire marshal. So don't miss the concert. And hope to see you there.
I'll go fast. Okay. I just wanted to give or bring everyone's attention to, in the announcements, we are listing the Granby Congregational Church Scholarship. I want to say thank you to those that took the time and the effort to really bring it to some great language, specific and intentful. Intentive. Anyways, full of intent. And I just want to encourage you all to donate to that. In the past, we've been able to give the scholarship to a variety of students. This past year, it went to a few students in Heartland, and we had extra funds to support another student from Hartford for her second year in a nursing program at Drexel. Our hope for this continued scholarship is to actually commit to a student for 4 years. If we raise enough money, 2 students for 4 years to get them through their higher education, and also to continue to support Harlem until she can graduate from Drexel. So if you have any questions about the scholarship, please come see me, and I'm happy to answer them. Is that fast enough?
Okay. With that in mind, collection plates are at both the front and the back of the congregate church if you want to donate. And also I would recommend say that you can donate online if you go to the webpage or any of these things, including the scholarship fund. There's an opportunity to do that online. We are an open and affirming church. We welcome you no matter who you are or where you are in your life and faith journeys. This is Husky Blue lanyard today. Those of you who are going to fall asleep during the sermon, Chuck will see if we can keep you going. So let our service continue.
Thank you. Good morning. The call to worship this morning is based on Psalm 118, verse 1. Please join me. Oh, give thanks to God this day, for God's steadfast love endures forever. God's steadfast love was with Jesus riding on a donkey into Jerusalem. God's steadfast love brought joy to the crowds as Jesus passed by. God's steadfast love empowered and guided Jesus as the week of Passion began. All God's steadfast love surrounds us now. Come, let us worship our God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
You may be seated.
Please join with me in our unison prayer of invocation. Ever faithful God, we have entered this sanctuary today to celebrate the day when Jesus entered the gates of Jerusalem for the final time. The week ahead for Jesus would be filled with passion, risk, decision, and sacrifice, yet the week would ultimately lead to triumph in new life. Like Jesus, we come before you today, dear God, with our own passions, risks, looming decisions, and opportunities to sacrifice for others. May our hearts and minds be open now to the movement of your Spirit, leading us along the paths of our lives through trials and challenges to triumph in new life, just as you led Jesus on this holy day long ago. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, Sarah has a message for us all.
Okay, kids, it's time to make your way back down for my message. Anyone young at heart, anyone who would like to just come forward for the message is welcome to come forward now. You're getting your steps in today, right? Are you wearing your watch, Jaden? No? One time in Sunday school, he kept going like this because he was trying to get his steps in, right? Hi, everyone. Good morning. On Palm Sunday, you know, a couple weeks, we've been talking about in our Pathfinders class, in our Sunday school class, we have been talking about Holy Week coming up, and Palm Sunday, and Easter, and what that all means. And someone in our class looked at me and said, well, that didn't really happen, right? Jesus didn't really do that. And it made me think, like, a lot of times we hear these stories of Jesus, right? We hear stories of Christmas and Jesus is born in the manger, and you hear stories of Holy Week and Easter and Jesus on the cross and then Jesus resurrected, and it kind of seems like a big fairy tale, right? It kind of seems like fiction. It kind of seems like folklore made up. So I wanted to remind everybody today that Jesus was human. Jesus was a human. Like me and like you, he had a human body. Jesus was a baby, right? So that means he cried and spit up and needed to burp. Jesus at one point was a toddler, probably running around trying to climb things. You have a one-year-old brother? Yeah, so you know what I'm talking about, right? Jesus was a kid, probably like, oh, do I need to do that, Mom? Right? Jesus was a teenager dealing with acne, probably. Right? Jesus was a man. Jesus grew up to be an adult. He cried tears and he bled blood and he was human. Jesus was human. So that means that he felt feelings too. And in the Bible, there's different times where we know that Jesus was compassionate and felt loving. There's times where we have read that Jesus felt angry. So Jesus was this human being. And today, Palm Sunday, we remember the story of Jesus coming to Jerusalem where he knew that people wanted to hurt him. He knew he was going to a place where people wanted to kill him. He knew that he was going to places that were not going to be safe for him. He knew this. So thinking about this human Jesus, this human being, this man who has feelings, how do you think he felt coming into Jerusalem? They didn't go to school back then? They probably had like a certain type of school, yeah. And then he like had to go to trade school and like do the carpentry stuff, right? Probably. But how do you think Jesus felt if he knew that he was going to Jerusalem and people there wanted him dead. If he knew it was going to happen, what do you think? How would you feel? What's the emotion that you would feel? Scared. Nervous, anxious, right? Jesus probably felt all those things because he was human. He probably felt so scared. And when I think about that, I think about, wow, that is how much Jesus loved us. That is how much Jesus loved you. That is how much Jesus loved me. That's how much Jesus loved everybody, that he would do that, even though he was probably scared and anxious. He chose to go to Jerusalem knowing that he was going to be hurt. That's how important his message is. That's how important and big God's love is. So when we hear the stories this week, Holy Week, and we think, wow, that's so far-fetched. Wow, that's unbelievable. That's really out there. Just remember, Jesus was a human being. So yes, this week was remarkable and miraculous. So now we're going to do an echo prayer, and then you guys can go back and sit with your grown-ups because we're going to stay in for communion today. Okay? So I want everyone to follow me in an echo prayer. Mother God, embrace us as we walk through Holy Week. Embrace us through celebration, sadness, and miracles. Let us not forget the depth of God's love. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. As we hear the words of scripture, let us listen in the words for the word of God. When they had come to near Jerusalem and had reached Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." "The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God shall stand forever."
Thank you. The people cried, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." I hope that is a feeling you have today, too, that you are hearing about you. Blessed are you who come in the name of the Lord today to celebrate Palm Sunday. This is a familiar story that we just heard, a critical turning point in the account of Jesus's last days. It's been told for almost 2,000 years. It's recorded in all four Gospels. which is kind of rare. Not many stories are recorded in, or accounts of Jesus' life are recorded in all four Gospels. So let's take a closer look. Jesus gives us on Palm Sunday the example of Christian character. But it really begins in, for me, in one verse in Luke that only appears in Luke. The story of Palm Sunday is in all the Gospels, but there's this one verse in Luke towards the end of chapter 9 where Jesus is at the end of a demanding journey and he pauses and Luke writes, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. That has always just been such a moving verse for me to read and to hear, that when the days came for Jesus to be received up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. That's what began the time we now refer to as Palm Sunday. It was a critical decision. Jesus was choosing risk over safety, the potential for arrest over freedom, death over life. He heads to Jerusalem, crowds followed. He could have presented himself as a descendant of the great King David, which he was thought to be. Instead, he came as a man of the people, a common one like everyone else. He could have ridden in on a noble steed, but came on a borrowed donkey. He chose humility over popularity. He didn't seek praise or adulation from the crowd. He received it, but he didn't seek it. He set his face to Jerusalem. He humbly approached, confidently and courageously. That's the picture of this Jesus we celebrate today. One of the difficulties for me as a minister, as a Christian, is that these days, much of Christianity, at least as it's popularly seen in the media, has forgotten this Jesus of Palm Sunday. What is commonly called evangelical Christianity, which I think that's a misnomer, but that's a whole sermon or maybe a series of sermons someday, has become the face for many of Christianity. But it's a face that often appears arrogant, judgmental, divisive, dismissive, and elitist. We are the one true religion, is what we hear coming from that voice sometimes. You don't get to heaven without following our rules. And believe it, you want to go to heaven, so you want to follow our rules. You're a sinner if you don't follow our rules. Not at all like the Jesus of Palm Sunday. Faces not turned towards Jerusalem, but towards privilege and preeminence. We're the ones going to heaven. Not like the one who entered Jerusalem gates with humility and God's will in his heart after he set his face to go to Jerusalem for the last time. So this, I think, presents a challenge for us today, which I think we all need to take up on this Palm Sunday, to be more visible as the face of the Jesus who entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, to show the world that Jesus challenged the privileged and powerful, who faced risk and harm with courage and with confidence, who resolved to follow God's will, not because he got admiration from the people and from the elite, but because he was being faithful to God. When we follow Jesus in this way, when we bring this face of Jesus to the world around us, we are blessed as well. So I thought I would leave you this morning with a few thoughts about what it means to feel blessed in the way that Jesus was received with the words, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." So consider these words our words. Maybe these words I'm about to speak are words that will guide the Granby Congregational Church as it continues to grow into this new congregation. Maybe each of us will live our lives in a way that reflects the Jesus of Palm Sunday if we feel blessed in these ways. So, blessed are we when we turn our gaze away from false prophets and set our faces toward Jesus. Blessed are we when we forsake wealth and materialism and choose instead to receive God's gifts, simple gifts of life. Blessed are we when we downplay our concern for our own personal salvation in favor of saving the poor, the disenfranchised, the forgotten. Blessed are we when we refuse to shrink back in fear when God calls and go forward like Jesus did today with confidence and conviction and courage. Blessed are we when we close our ears to the preaching of prosperity and primacy and listen keenly for Jesus' voice calling us to live with humility and selflessness. Blessed are we when we value the safety and being and well-being of children above everything else. Blessed are we when we come together in the name of our God and in the spirit of our Savior to love, to witness, to serve, and to rejoice together as we rejoice this day. Amen. As we enter our time of prayer, I have these prayers that have been brought to me this morning. A joy, the single daffodil on the communion table is in celebration of the birth of John August Adams, son of Mandy and Ben Adams, proud grandparents John and Cindy Adams. Prayers for a family member who has had triple bypass surgery. Prayers for a family member who is dealing with a neurological disorder. And prayers for broken friendships. Thanksgiving for the upcoming spring season. And prayers of healing for Keith, George, and Mike, three friends that were injured while skiing at Steamboat 2 weeks ago. If there are any others, you can put your hand up. Yes, and also please, as remember, we are live streaming, to be careful about not sharing anything that might be too private or too sensitive to be going out to all the world. Lori. Take your time. Thank you, Lori. Thank you. For Lori's brother and his family, he is diagnosed with fourth stage cancer.
Yes, yeah.
And spread to the bone. So please, for Lori's brother and his family, and for her. Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm wrong. I'll pray for you. Some good news. You all have heard my son Clayton write at the Performing Church many times. And I just want to leave you with this. He went live on Spotify this week. So please download him and support us. We're excited and I hope you love it.
Thank you. Thank you. Others? Yes. Amen. Thank you. Then let's be in prayer together, and we'll begin with a few moments of silence for you to bring to God other things that are deep in your hearts but might not be things you'd like to speak. Let's take a few moments of silence for you to share those with God. What a grand day this is, dear God, a day to be joyful, expectant, inspired, and alive. It's a day to remember how Jesus was courageous and humble, regal and approachable, strong and soft, all at the same moment as he entered the gates of the great city of Jerusalem for the last time. Help us to see Jesus in this same way as we celebrate Palm Sunday today, Holy God. Help us to receive Jesus into our hearts as the carpenter Messiah who can fulfill all our dreams and needs. For we are like the people in the crowds that lined the street into Jerusalem that day, God, the ones who shouted, Hosanna, and spread palm branches and garments upon the ground before him. Like them, some of us today have reason to celebrate and rejoice, and others of us are hurting and weary. Still others are unsure of what the future will bring. So help us to feel the deep and powerful presence of our Savior here now, dear God, as real and as loving as when he was entering the city so long ago. May his courage, his faith, his hope, his power, his humility, his determination, and most of all, his love fall upon each one of us, reassuring us that our prayers today have been heard and received, and there is resurrection awaiting us all just a short time away, just around the corner, as always, in the time and manner you know best. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And let's continue praying the words that Jesus gave us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen. As Bob mentioned earlier, we are receiving communion today as the trays are passed into the pews to you. The bread will be passed first and followed by the cup. We ask that you, when you receive the bread, to take the bread individually as you desire, but to, when you receive the cup, to hold that, and we will receive that all together. One symbolizing our individual faith and the other symbolizing our corporate faith. And there will be trays that have bread and some others that are have gluten-free matzah in them as well. You will find the order for communion inside the bulletin, inside where you had seen the hymn earlier in the scripture lesson. It's the inside portion of that. And I invite you to begin to say that with me. There are, as we typically have, there are parts that say one, and I will be the one. And you can be the all. How's that? Let's begin. Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit, source of life, living word, and bond of love, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who reminds us that even in challenging days, as when Jesus entered Jerusalem for the last time, your eternal love arises and never leaves us. We rejoice with all your people and with the angels because we know that whenever we place our faith fully in you, we need never fear. And so we proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy is Jesus,
God incarnate, the risen Christ, whose mercy gathers us together in community, whose grace meets us in our brokenness, and whose loving faithfulness gives us renewed hope. In this meal, we remember Jesus, his promises, and the price he paid for who he was, what he said, and what he did for our benefit. On the night before Jesus died, he took a loaf of bread and gave thanks and broke it. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup and poured. Saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." In sharing this meal, we live out the mystery of our faith. We remember Christ's life of love and friendship and teaching. We remember Christ dying and rising to life again. Bless this bread and this cup, the wheat and the grape, the farmer and the harvest, the seed and the sower. These simple elements are shared in community so that we may taste and see your goodness and become one body in Christ. For it is through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, that all glory is yours, most holy God, now and forevermore. Amen. We now bring you this bread. When you receive and partake, remember that this is the bread of life given to us by Jesus. Friends, this is the cup of the new covenant. Take and drink, remembering that Christ died so that we may have life. Please join me responsibly in our prayer of thanksgiving. O Christ, we thank you for this feast of life. Fed by your love and strengthened by your life, we humbly accept your call to go into this world, to live with hope, and to share your joy. You commission us to feed as we have been fed, forgive as we have been forgiven, and love as we have been loved. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our parting hymn is number 215 in the Black New Century Hymnals, Ride On, Ride On in Majesty. Our benediction is in the bulletin and on the screen. Now unto the one who is able to keep us from falling,
and lift us from the dark valley of despair to the bright mountain of hope,
from the midnight of desperation to the daybreak of joy,
to God.